Dear friend, these images and sounds were registered 27 years ago in University Square. In Romanian language, it's "Don't kill us," and "Libertate," the last, is a freedom. But the story of liberty for Romanians is a long story. And I would like to begin with a confession. I was born in 1939. If that year someone would have crossed the Eurasian continent from the Pacific to the Atlantic Ocean, would have crossed from Tokyo to Lisbon, only state under civil or military dictatorship. My family lived in a town located on the Dniester River, on the Soviet border. We were twice forced to take refuge from the Red Army, Soviet Red Army, alongside tens of thousands of people, and my first memories are related to this disparate exodus. For those who failed to leave were mostly arrested or deported to Siberia and finally killed. I lived until the age of 50 under dictatorship in a country from which you could not leave and where we were fixed for life in a particular place established by government distribution. My country was like a prison, a dictatorship that would only recognize state of collective ownership, that canceled all freedom of expression, and that oversaw the personal life of every citizen through a huge political police unit. I crossed a post-totalitarian transition whose social price was heavily paid for those of my generation. Democracy and liberty is not an abstract concept, and any situation that undermines democracy and prejudices freedom affect us deeply. The Second World War caused the death of more than 25 million soldiers and over 73 million civilians, caused huge economic losses and destructions of the world cultural heritage. The atrocities of the two wars in the first half of the 20th century proved not to be sufficient in order to understand that Western civilization cannot be strengthened only through the assertion of the cultural superiority or by managing frozen conflicts. At the end of the Second World War, the United Nations General Assembly adopted and signed the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the first document with universal calling mean to defend the real values of humanity. Few suspected that this document and the principle would be so brutally violated in Eastern Europe. What determines such an attitude? The answer can only be found in the contrast between the surface politics of the Soviet Empire member states and the communist ideology adopted by them. Communism is a devilish mechanism where the foundation of civilization have been replaced by the communist dictatorship with ideological substitutes in a tenacious attempt to transform the history of a half of century in a tragic experience for all humanity. amid a precarious peace secured during the Cold War by the arms race, the price paid by the citizens of the communist states in Eastern Europe was millions of deaths, tens of millions of human lives destroyed. Talking about freedom, a fundamental human right, beyond the Iron Curtain, countries of the free world could only assist, most often helplessly, to the struggle of those for which communism has become a fact. The only way of helping them seemed to be that of raising awareness of human rights to all those for which the only reality seems to be fact that enforced by the communist regimes. On August 1st, 1975, occurred an event that will have historical consequences. 33 heads of state of government of European countries, together with United States and Canadian leaders, signed a final act of the Conference on Security and Cooperation in Europe, ratifying the inviolability of state borders at the end of the Second World War, but which also includes a so-called third basket concerning the free circulation of ideas and people. The Helsinki Act was considered by the leader of the Soviet Union and other communist countries in Eastern Europe a great victory, consecrating the borders of the Soviet Empire established by force at the end of the Second World War. But the democrat intellectual, however, understands the chance they are being given. The fall of communism was, of all things, an ideological collapse that prepared the political collapse of dictatorship in most countries of the former Soviet bloc. Culture played a fundamental role in this context. Parallel to the official speech, an underground speech was created, meant to denounce deception and falsity and to reject those who stopped thinking, what said Havel at the time. The danger for the super-armed Soviet Empire of a cold or hot war did not come from the West, otherwise successfully confronted. The danger did not come from the American missiles. It came from the intellectuals in their own countries, despised by the members of the communist apparatus. The danger came through the war of the democratic intellectuals and through their writing, illegally disseminated by poor means. For those who experienced communism and had to cross the post-communist transition period, nothing is more true and instructive than the reading of the Exodus. We understand best why it took 40 years for the Hebrew people to reach the Holy Land, what the worship of the golden calf, the temptation of collective dissipation, violence and treasons, the need of the table of the laws, and a punishment for failing to comply with the Ten Commandments being. The collapse in 1989 of the communist dictatorship in the Soviet Union and in Southeastern Europe and their replacement with the democratic regimes put an end to huge causalities. For the younger generation, liberated from the communist constraint, the struggles of their parents my dream has an issue more connected to the past than to a present marked by another type of political, economic, and social crisis. And so, those subject to suffering and lack of freedom. Nevertheless, those who still bear alive the memory of that era are the main artisans of tackling the human rights issue from a contemporary perspective. The horrors of the bygone era have left their mark on the mind of the entire ex-communist space. The millions of dead people from the communist camps can see plain statistical data for some contemporaries, but historical memory remains the element explaining why people from former communist countries refuse to accept totalitarian approaches regardless of the code they are putting forward. The pedagogy of freedom needs a memory of suffering because, as in the case of health, we perceive the value of freedom when we no longer have it. But what will happen when the last survivors of the gulags will disappear? In order to avoid the return of totalitarian system, the need to restore or to introduce a separation of powers has been keenly questioned. The principle of the separation of power, it means to put barrier to the desire for seizing power and keeping it by enemies. In 1992, when I was a professor in American University, in Duke University, on the East Coast, I had the opportunity to visit the memorial houses of the founding fathers of the United States democracy. In each of these austere and modest houses, there were the works of the Greek tragedies authors in the libraries and a Bible on the nightstand. I believe that a tenacious reading of the Old and New Testament made them understand the true nature of the human being, its struggle between good and evil. Why? Because for me it is risky to establish for the defense of democracy a single consensus around the idea of good. We can suspect that for centuries to come, each society will have its own idea of its earthly and spiritual well-being. It seems in this situation more reasonable ones, we cannot always identify the common good to identify evil for starters. It is in the interest of all nations to meet on the rejection ground of what they consider intolerable. I am sure that all those present here refuse war, terrorism, torture, pollution, opinion offense, xenophobia, racism and genetic manipulation, minors' exploitation, social exclusion, famine, professional discrimination based on sex, religion, or ethnicity. We have the duty to diagnose these pathologies together, as we can together heal the wounds they continue to cause. Unfortunately, I found that democracy is not a perennial idea of the human being, but rather a dream of those deprived of it. Democracy is, however, the best power-sharing tool. Power is one of the most powerful motivation of human actions. It can become a dangerous drug for those who have it. From my life experience, I believe that power related to a head of state function is merely a conjecture or an illusion. The moral value of power appears only in the confrontation between this formal power and the person who temporarily holds it. If this as a person dominated by power, or can he dominate it through wisdom and common sense? The head of state position can, in truth, transform existence into destiny, only if the difficult cohabitation between ideal and reality can produce a significant change in the history of a nation. I come back to the moment when free world peace through democracy. European Union was born as a political project at the end of the Second World War, when the human destruction capacity rather exceeded the apocalypse image. It is born in Western Europe, out of the need to overcome the huge suffering of tens of millions of people victims of the Nazi totalitarian ideology, and has shown that after Europe unleashed two world wars, democracy could ensure peace in a free world for 7 decades. I had the opportunity to participate this time directly alongside intellectuals from Poland, the Czech Republic, Slovakia, Hungary, Bulgaria, and the Baltic countries, released in 1989-1990 from under the Soviet domination in the democracy expansion project in the central Southeastern Europe. Democracy then offered a perspective to the people traumatized by the communist tyranny. Democracy based on moral principles continues to be a solution even today, where totalitarian regimes still exist, where sufferings must be overcome and reconciliation must be achieved. And I'm now engaged in this project with all my strength. Other subject I propose to talk about is freedom and bread. Sure, bread is a metaphor. Debating the relation between power and freedom also targets the distribution on wealth. In the Karamazov Brothers novel by Dostoevsky, Ivan tells Alyosha that if people would be asked to choose between freedom and bread, they would choose bread. This is also, I understood in reality what happened after the fall of the totalitarian regime. It was the psychological foundation on which totalitarian regimes ground themselves in order to obtain a consensual obedience. A significant part of the population of the former communist countries regrets the times when they had poorly paid but safe jobs, lived in miserable condition but in houses received following the government allocation, and they were given minimum food rationed by cards. The most psychological element stopping rebellion was paradoxically the fact that everyone was equally poor and they did not feel humiliated one in relation to the others. it's important to understand the return of to the democratic political life of the neo-communist parties is based on this nostalgia. In the democratic society with market economy, freedom is followed by a chase after material goods that creates significant differences between the rich and the poor, differences that are often not correlated with the quality and quantity of work performed and with the contribution to the general welfare of society. And this surpasses the momentum of the ones they made the creed from the freedom of the Western societies. On the opposite direction, according to libertarians, anything added to the opportunities for economic growth raises welfare, and it is normal for some to win more than others. In relation between freedom and democracy, to begin with, we can try to distinguish between freedom as a fundamental human right and our two concepts that mobilize the energy of the civil society, such as the rule of law and democracy. Following the experience under the communist regime, we can understand the ease of the totalitarian regimes in accepting the rule of law principle, but this understanding compliance with their own laws. I saw how the free election slogans that I voiced in front of the tanks and weapons of the communist repression apparatus can be used to seize power by the former communist nomenclature or new oligarchs. I saw how a showcase democracy can disguise real democracy. I saw how the manipulation of public opinion through free press of oligarchy can be more efficient in the market economy and democracy than the communist propaganda disseminated by official media of the totalitarian regime was, in which no one believed anymore. I saw how the authors of crimes and perpetrators against their own people can escape criminal liability by prescriptions because agreements on genocides are not applicable to them and general recognition of the crime against humanity is delayed. One of the last problems I propose for reflection is the decay of Western civilization and the vulnerability of democracy. The Western civilization is going through a period of decay, in my opinion, marked by the shift from a real economy to a speculative economy, from welfare society to consumer society, by the degradation of the political system through populism and demagogy, disappearance of visionary leaders and their replacement with managers of presidential governmental terms, concealing reality through politically correct language, involution from the democratization of culture and education to their massification at the cost of quality pay, mass media embezzlement, once the watchdog of democracy to commercial objectives, acceptance of the positive manipulation by the intellectual elites to the detriment of scientific truth to provide funding for research and environmental protection. All these have a long-term effect on the democratic conscience. Individual freedom and democracy can only survive in a society represented by aware citizens and not by an amorphous mass of easily manipulated individuals. Western democracy is currently threatened by the increasingly visible presence of a toxic triangle at the top: administration, corporation, mass media. The presidential candidates resemble each other increasingly more, have increasingly reduced obligation towards the citizens and increasing obligation towards corporations, drawing a dangerous road from democracy to plutocracy that does not only affect the American economy, but also the global one. The side slip of the political speech is also encouraged by the lack of the culture of democracy, by the utopian presentation of democracy as power of all people, an ideal model nowhere reached to this day. We overlook the fact that on the long and difficult road from tyranny to freedom, the two classical models of democracy, Athenian and American, legislated slavery and eliminated any voting rights for women, invoking the democratos, people power, etymology, leads to a false perception of the Athenian model, where in reality the power of decision did not only belong to freemen, but was also limited to refined ones and taxpayers, the poor being excluded. The historical model of American democracy did not grant at the beginnings any rights not only to blacks, slaves, but also limited the presence of Jews and Catholics in form. If we comprehend that today American democracy is the result of a long evolution, it is then hard to justify the impatience toward its adaptation by society that have never in their history knew freedom. The assimilation of democratic consciousness needs more time than the one required by the adoption of democratic laws and democratic institutions. Let us remember that when the American system of power separation was exported to Latin America or Southeast Asia, it invariably led to totalitarian regimes until a democratic conscience able to ensure the functioning of a democratic institution was formed. Another danger is the attraction, especially in last time, attraction of direct democracy, exercised through referendums or under street pressure, which is dangerous because it leads to quasi totalitarian regimes. Most authoritarian leaders in Africa or Asia have obtained power through referendum and reinforced it through rigid elections. Democratic culture is threatened at the beginning of the third millennium also by the dominant postmodern culture that seems to invalidate the appeal to the ideals of the European Union founding father. Political leaders, like as ordinary citizens, seem to ignore the social significance of governance by thrift, virtue and moderation, essential moral values. Perhaps exactly a return to these values, given that the social cost of governance are supported increasingly harder, where society is rapidly being divided between the privileged and the disadvantaged, could be a reconstruction source of politics on other grounds than the collectivism imposed during communism or the selfish individualism in capitalism. Return to moral values could be an alternative to the careless or contentious attitude towards the needs and the requirement of those treated only as a mass of voters, of producers and consumers of goods or information. Paul Valéry justly condemned the governance where politics is just the art of consulting people in relation to affairs they do not understand and preventing people from taking part in affairs which properly concern them. The 20th century has brought an extraordinary freedom for all racial, ethnic, sexual, professional and political minorities. What it has been lost is solidarity. Solidarity, which is a supreme form of freedom and the foundation of social power that we need, does not only start from mutual understanding or even from people's sense of compassion, but from their participation in a joint work in the service of a common idea. Reading Saint-Exupéry once again, we will remember that love does not consist in gazing at each other, but in looking our together in the same direction. And finally, it's about the freedom to choose. Democracy as a system for ensuring individual freedom is a fragile product that must be defended by the danger that comes from the tyranny of the unit leader, from the tyranny of the majority, and even of aggression of former oppressed minorities. Between freedom and tyranny, democracy is a necessary but not sufficient premise to ensure a fair division of power. For the intellectual elites that build ideologies and social projects, democracy involves a permanent choice between utopia and realism. Scientists must not forget that if in science utopia is a mother of progress, in politics utopia has always and all over the world been the mother of criminal totalitarian regimes. Those elected to high leadership roles based on free elections find themselves when making decisions before a fundamental choice, whether they want to do something for the good of those who elected them, sometimes against their own will, or want to be re-elected. Most often, the team they are working with or the party that promoted them will pressure them to adopt those measures that would lead to their re-election in order to perpetuate the powers earlier. And in my experience, I know very, very well what happened to change two terms in election in all Central Asia. In the long run, for the survival of the quality of democracy, the essential factor is the democratic conscience of those who choose freely. I come back to the Karamazov brothers. In the Karamazov brothers, Dostoevsky tells that man prefers peace and even death to freedom of choice in the knowledge of good and evil. Nothing is more seductive for man, for his freedom of conscience, but nothing is a greater cause of suffering. Dostoevsky wrote these lines in the 19th century from the perspective of some people that had never knew individual freedom or democracy. 100 years later, in December 1989. Young people who demonstrated against the communist dictatorship in University Square in Bucharest did not ask neither for bread nor for higher wages. They voiced free elections, you can hear, free elections, freedom of the press, and especially freedom, we love you, we die for you, and we will die and we will be free. At midnight, the repression troops went in with tanks against the unarmed demonstrators, who did not threaten any governmental institution and offer flowers to the military. Dozens of people were killed and thousands arrested and tortured. The next day, 500,000 of Bucharesters surrounded the tanks. The dictator fled and freedom was gained. In one of history's bright moments, people were willing to die for freedom and democracy. The answer regarding the future of freedom and democracy is a choice of each generation and eventually of each of us. Thank you for your attention.